I welcome everyone to more webinar from TPA Amsterdam. My name is Marina. I work here at TPA Amsterdam, and I would like to just give a few announcements. If you want your microphone to be unmuted, please, you can use the raise your hand function. And if you want to make any questions during the presentation, you're welcome to do so. And just please raise your hand again, and I unmute you. Now I will give you the floor to Jan Akkermans and Nick Blumendaal. Welcome, guys, and yeah.
Okay, thank you. We'll do a brief introduction of ourselves and then go through the agenda that we have prepared for you. I've got a background in customs of 16 years. After that, followed by over 20 years of consultancy in the customs and international trade area.
My name is Nick Blumendaal. I'm a supply chain specialist that comes to this subject from a operational perspective, and therefore I joined forces with Jan to raise Expertech Digital, where I'm taking the operational side of things.
As Nick said, we founded XBT Digital earlier this year, coming from an idea that customs is, especially here in the Netherlands, customs is more and more digitizing the audits, but also the way how you communicate with customs, in terms of entries, declarations, requesting for authorizations, licenses, etc. This means that customs in itself also is turning to digital means to control all the transactions, to control all the flows. Now, I will go into that later on, because I have to explain a little bit how customs over here works and what developments we see in the nearby future, so that it becomes clear what the starting point for the platform is that we will discuss in the second part of the webinar. As an agenda, I just want to go through the scope of customs and the way how customs enforce the responsibilities, liabilities, etc., that you face when cross-border products. Do a brief introduction on the way how you minimize or even avoid customs duties when entering into the European Union for a certain part that can be applicable to other parts of the world as well, but there are also parts in the world, countries that not use the way how we deal with avoiding customs duties over here. They use drawback systems in order to be sure that customs duties are only levied once. From that, I'll give you insight in the details that customs have interest in once you have filed your entries, once you have paid your levies, in order to be sure that everything is compliant. And the audit file in itself is, as we have mentioned it at this moment in the agenda, as audit file logistics. This name is a temporary name because the audit file is under construction. We then will switch to our platform in order to identify what it can support. And then maybe, because up to that moment, everything is based on the levy of customs duties, anti-dumping levies, etc. We also elaborate a little bit on export compliance, where you talk about sanction lists, etc., that might be applicable once you export or import products. Scope of customs. Traditionally, customs is responsible for the levy of duties and taxes at import. In the EU, at this moment, we don't have any levies upon export, but if existing, these would be part of the scope of customs as well. Now, what you will see is that there are a number of duties and levies that are applicable once you enter goods into the European Union. Listed a couple of examples. Customs duties, anti-dumping levies are the most important, of course, where if you talk about turnover tax at import, it's more how to avoid it in order to avoid a negative cash flow. Now, that is a separate webinar, so we will not go into detail into that one. But it might be clear that if customs monitor the flows of goods and the related customs duties, they will start using more and more a digitized tool on their side in order to determine the compliance. Now, what you there see then is customs who not only use themselves dedicated control frames or control frameworks, but also expect companies to have these control frameworks in place. The control frameworks, in combination with analytics of the data that you gather throughout your supply chain when entering goods or exporting goods in and out of the country, is of course a development within customs, which is pretty new. Yep. The way how customs deal with this is that they want to see from an export perspective that, and that is, I think, the approach of the World Customs Organization within their project, where they say, once you have controlled your export, if you control the entire supply chain, then more or less you're also in control with your imports. You see a moving from customs attention from imports to exports and the other way around. These, of course, are developments that are pretty new. It might be very clear that customs at this moment upon import not only focuses on the fiscal, so the financial part of the import, but also on the compliance with sanctions, sanctions lists, with all legislation that comes with strategic products, dual use, but also chemical goods. And what becomes more and more important, the role of customs on legislation that deals with human, veterinary, and also phytosanitary aspects in order to safeguard the European Union within a global context for all the risks that that do exist, and for which we at this moment also start feeling the consequences. Fact that a lot of not native products, plants, animals have been imported in the EU, nowadays caused quite a lot of stress in order to avoid that. Let's say the environment remains a little bit safeguarded, and customs has a more and more important role in safeguarding that. So there you see that they not have a real-time task, but that they start using a more ad hoc retrospective approach, checking that everything has gone well. Retrospective means at this moment that customs can go back 5 years, but even in certain circumstances back 10 years, and that of course is quite a burden to any company that imports or exports from the European Union. Given the fact that the flow of goods throughout the world has grown to an extent that there isn't any customs administration in this world that still can say that they control all the flows, especially all the volumes, has turned to a couple of concepts that have been developed together with the World Customs Organization, but also been downloaded into the European Committee, further developed in the local member states, customs administrations of the member states in Europe. And that's where you see that risk analysis is a very important tool for customs. What, especially in the Netherlands, is done is that the entire supply chain is cut up in three flows. One flow is where the participants have a authorization and in the past a certification, which is called authorized economic operator. So you prove prior to any movement towards customs that you are in control, that you know what you are talking about, that you know all the risks, and that you've taken the appropriate measures to avoid the consequences of all the risks. Then, of course, you've got a separate flow where customs say, okay, if we know the entire supply chain from manufacturer, exporter to, in the end, the importer and the customer here in the EU, that can result in trade facilitation. And means that once we know these flows, we don't have to pay that much attention to them as to the other flow. And the other flow is then the flow that has not been determined. The other flow is also regarding companies that have a regular imports, exports in out the EU, but who have also, that can also be smugglers, that can also be terrorists. So you can imagine that customs, from their point of view, from their enforcement point of view, would like to have most time spent on the blue lane, as they have identified, in order to be sure that risks are minimized as much as possible and compliance is enforced to a maximum. Now, what they do with that is that they work with concepts like secured and smart trade lanes. Secured means that they have interest in the physical integrity of shipments, of consignments. That can be one box, but it can also be one container. What is important to customs is that integrity in that relation means the consignment that I've shipped as a manufacturer, as an exporter, is exactly the same as that is received by the importer. No products have been added to that consignment. And you can imagine, especially in the context of terrorists, that that is a important enforcement topic for customs. And then, of course, you've got the second one, and that is using digital data that is available from these supply chains. More and more, this will be done by retrospective gathering of information, and not just the information that is available from the entries, from the customs declarations, from entries into customs warehouse declarations. Now, it is also about the exchange of data between economic operators, and I'll come in a moment to which these data can be consist of, and the local customs administration. It can be the exchange of customs versus customs within the European Union. It can also be, and that is over the last 2-3 years becoming more important, the exchange of data from local customs administrations to the central EU Commission, and then of course the various departments that are interested in and exports of goods. What is important to know, and then we come back to that first flow, the green flow, the authorized economic operator context, is that customs is coming from an angle that the economic operator should be in control. Should be in control is not just looking at the data from a perspective, is my amount of duties correct, but it's from a perspective, do I control the entire supply chain that I'm that as a result of which I've got imports, that I've got exports. Now, what is important in this context is a development which will become important for VAT, and that is the introduction of the certified taxable person. Now, for those operators, economic operators, that already hold an AEO authorization, they've got the advantage that almost automatically they will also will get the certification as a certified taxable person, which will be important as of 2021. Like I said, for VAT, and there you see, because one of the questions that you hear quite a lot, what is the advantage of AEO? Here is an additional advantage for the future, that once you have the AEO authorization here in the the EU, you will be considered to be a certified taxable person as well. What is the background of these two certifications? You know your stuff. And once you know what you're talking about, once you know what your risks are, you also know what the measures are that you have to take to be compliant. I already mentioned in the introduction that customs is also about minimizing and avoiding customs duties. It might surprise you, but customs have a starting point that they have to levy the amount that is applicable, not more, not less. And of course, from a operator's point of view, we do exactly the same if we talk about customs planning. Now, the big problem in, well, not problem, it's the difference of the EU system versus, for instance, the US system, is that once you've entered goods into free circulation here in Europe, you will not get a refund of the duties if these goods subsequently are exported outside the EU again. So the final destination is not the EU. Goods are just trespassing through the EU. In the United States, they have a drawback system. That means that you pay duties upon entry, but upon export, either of the product itself or when it is processed in a compensating product, of that compensating product, the customs duties upon entry will be refunded. Over here, we need a if you don't do anything with the goods, you need a customs warehouse. Means that the goods remain under customs supervision. You don't have to pay the duties. And once the goods are re-exported outside the EU, you definitely don't have to pay any customs duties. If you talk about any handling of the products, or maybe even processing of the products, you don't have enough on an authorization for a customs warehouse. You also need authorizations for inward processing, and it might even be that one of the other authorizations for instance, for temporary admission, that they are applicable. Now, in the past, a customs warehouse or inward processing was all enforced and the compliance was checked through combining the paper entries upon entry and on exportation. As you all know, nowadays everything is digitized. So your manufacturing process or your storage process is all being done through specialized systems. And customs have already learned that these systems give them quite a lot of information, not only the systems itself, but also the way how you audit your supply chain, how you audit your in-house procedures, processes, and of course, the relation between the various systems that you can identify. We will show that later on in a graphic overview, but what I'm talking about is compliance of information or that is available in an ERP system or in a warehouse management system or in a traffic management system together with a duty management system that forms, together with these other systems, the basis for a customs warehouse record system or an IPR record system. Customs, like I said, is more and more turning to a digitized environment, and that can be concluded from the fact that, well, especially here in the Netherlands, as an example for the EU, you can't do any other entry than through a digital means, which is a entry generator that communicates with the entry handling system of customs. Now, of course, these can be a different type of declarations. It can be an entry into customs warehouse. It can be an entry into free circulation for re-export or export, of course. So that's there's quite a variety of entries that are possible. Your in-house record system is the basis for customs to identify that the supply chain is followed on a one-to-one basis, and therefore customs will use that in order to conclude that you are in control. But of course, is important as well is these details that customs are interested in, and that comes from the formula customs value multiplied by the tariff results in the applicable customs duties, the amount of customs duties. Now, the customs value as such is a topic which is very interesting to talk about, but it's also very interesting for customs to audit. And that is the old-fashioned feeling that customs still have the moment that they can assess as a result of finding mistakes either in the classification or in the rate, if you talk about inappropriate use of preferentials documents, or if the customs value in itself is not established or determined in a correct way. They can assess, and an assessment for customs is still the best way to identify that they have been productive. Whereas you've seen before, the scope of the customs is much broader than just levying. But hey, this is still a relic, an historical relic that I think will vanish over the next decades. That's something that customs will have to deal with. Now, knowing that customs is so interested in classification, in valuation, but also in origin, you can imagine that if you can do some retrospective checks yourself, but also proactive checks yourself. Start using standing file data, being 100% sure that these standing file data are, first of all, correct, but also processed correctly in the rest of the processing of data, then you understand why a tool as an audit file will become a strong tool preventing that customs checks, customs audits are going to surprise you, because you upfront know whether or not something has gone wrong, or even better, that you determine yourself, now what has been processed so far is 100% correct. You can make a distinction between the data where you say, okay, I've got a planning interest on my data. That means that you evaluate the data of all your transactions over the past, whereby you say, okay, I see certain structures. And these big data help you then in the planning area. So determining which is the best source to source my products from. Where do I pay the least customs duties? But also determine afterwards on your imports, have my prices that I've paid for my products, have these been consistent? Or is there a big fluctuation? What can be the reason for that fluctuation? What, of course, is important as well is reconciliation of the data which you have in your commercial system and the data that you hold in your customs systems. If there is a mismatch between the two, you can, of course, imagine that customs will start asking you questions due to the fact that the basis for everything for customs is your operational data that you use. That in combination with the customs data form the backbone of your customs record system. And and that is doubtful, but that is something that you will have to do also, and I think that that will be more and more occurring in the future, is that you reconcile the data that you filed to customs in terms of entries or declarations, the return messages that you get from customs, that you reconcile the contents of these return messages with the messages that you've lodged yourself. Turns out that there are quite often situations where there are mistakes within the customs, the declaration handling systems, through which your data can be influenced, and therefore the amount of levies can be different from what you have expected. These are all elements at this moment that you can say, fine, that is something that you can do retrospectively. You can do that on a temporary basis. You can also do that on a real-time basis. Depends on the tools that you have in-house. I already mentioned that part of the data will come from various departments within a company. That can be sales, that can be procurement, that can be warehousing, can be expedition. A lot of functions that deal with parsing, with establishing a supply chain, whether it's an incoming or an outgoing, but in the end, it will be resulting in a revenue, and that then is the basis for your company. So customs will be interested in that part of the operation and of your record systems. And that is data that you share with customs. You can share it with the customs administration as such, but it can also be information that you share with any third party. Think, for instance, that you use a customs broker for your entries. Think, for instance, that you have a forwarding company hired and that is dealing with any documents, for instance, under the transit system. In the end, if you are the one who issues the transit documents, you will remain responsible for the correct clearance of these declarations, even if you use third parties for that. So being in control, also based on the data that you retrieve from these third parties, can be viable for the future. Now, knowing that, you are now already showing for 2 or 3 minutes to a landscape how the various systems are interconnected. And what we see is a development going on, that's the audit file logistics. The audit file in itself is a set of data that is used by both public accountants, but also by income tax, corporate income tax, sales tax accountants from the tax authorities, to be sure that they get all the data that is necessary to determine that everything has gone compliant. This is an audit file that is developed under the umbrella of ISO. In the Netherlands, the NEN organization is involved in that development. And the starting point is that if you have a structure of the audit file on an ISO basis, you've got a global structure, you've got a global context. Now, here in the Netherlands, we now have the situation that a former declaration method, and that is called the periodic automated filing, that has to be replaced. It no longer answers to the requirements as entered in the Union Customs Code. And there is a movement going on. There is a project group within customs, together with software suppliers and with traders, that will develop an audit file logistics. Like I said, logistics is not the final name for it, but it is something that we have to deal with. And yes, of course, you can use the audit file for customs purposes, but you can also use them for in-house purposes, because the moment that you have identified that everything is correct, you can pass on the audit file with much more trust to the authorities than if you haven't performed any checks on that. Leo? So you happy enough, thing?
So how would it then operationally work to make sure that you get this audit file in place in the right way? If you look at this overview of platform that we are operating to do this compliance checks, is from left to right, then you see the data entry on the left hand side coming from those various sources. They can be connected to a data connector that we have, and the first result is then going to be a raw data file. The raw data file needs to be cleansed and validated against what to be expected, and some of that, most of that, can be done automatically or digitized by using additional business rules and data sources that we have added, and some need to be done through an interactive scrubbing exercise where we provide a user interface for, and it gives you also then the warning of missing data or data that needs to be updated. So that's the user interface on the back end or on the bottom end, so to speak. Finally, also the actual filing will go through this user interface going forward. So what we don't do with this platform is the actual filing. That's something that that is that system will still be in place down there. Once all of that data and that this audit audit file comes becomes available, it will be and it's clean and 100% correct. It will be stored in a data warehouse, and as my colleague Jan just explained, it can then be used for a number of activities, like incident logs that you for sure need to show your authorized economic operator authorization and the compliance that you have down there, that you are in control, that you have the incidents logged, and that you have taken action on those incidents. Progress filings and status updates on where you are with filings and with the compliant provision of data. And least and the most important is our compliance dashboards that we can then start providing, making sure that even CFOs have a good night rest, making sure that you know all of their filing operations are being looked at and secured and have a secured compliance overview. How would such a dashboard look like? As you can see, this is just an example where we put some screenshots together. On the left-hand side, there's the high-level checks on management information, validation control, compliance control, and process control. And each of those you can dig into further and have more detail if you go along. So on the right-hand side, there is a dashboard that, that a customer of ours uses to work and to make sure that they have the correct management information going forward. If you can see, the compliance control is marked yellow here. And if you drill into that one, you get into what we call a good flow compliance check that we make, where as part of your being in control, you have to make sure that on each period, your when you do a API filing, your total inventory has to be zero. The end inventory on the end of the period is always reported negative. So the starting inventory less all the transactions that you make, less of your starting inventory has to be have a balance of zero for the period, for your currency, for each customer, and for each product in itself. As you can see here, there's a difference of 25 pieces. Which came because of the period starting inventory was not correct, and therefore you know you get a highlight that says basically says you do need to review this and make sure that that this this gets right. Cycle counts were 80, which was 1% of all records, which is the standard, which is okay. Rebalance value was zero, so the cycle counts were good, and the rebalance quantity was zero as well. So this was a particular example on how one level deeper you can get your compliance automated and reported to your processing fellow workers. One of the other key things is how can you avoid having people keying in data, making mistakes going forward. This, for instance, is an overview of where we used coding to pick up on specific data for a physical representation of VAT, where you can see that through the import, we got a VAT bill number, which was lacking one digit, and it was lacking the letters in the front of it. In essence, through the platform, there's no need to re-enter that manually. You can use basic data, and for instance, VIES database to automatically correct that and use the corrected data to get your filing done. And then you have your audit results reported back, being all okay. On the right-hand side, you see something different is that on the left-hand side, there's the invoice information for your VAT filing. On the right-hand side, there is needed information from a logistics point of view. So the invoice number, which is the third row on this side, is connected to the invoice number from logistic data, in this particular case from DHL, where all of the data that also are needed to do a thorough and correct VAT audit is automatically stored into the system whilst we have a connection with this DHL tracking and tracing application. The only key thing that's still missing is the delivery date, and obviously the user interface will then give you reporting that says that this is still missing. But if you get the delivery dates, then it can also be automatic updated through the data connector going forward.
Okay, so far we discussed possibilities of using an audit file, using a tool, of looking at the financial data resulting in the end at levies. We also are working on a platform that supports the export compliance. Of course, there are already tools available that give you insight in sanction lists, in the status of products being dual use and what to do with that. It gives you information about the export certificates that you require for other means. But there is no platform available that checks retrospectively whether or not everything has been processed correctly, and especially in time. Because here you see, and that's what I meant with the other solutions that are available in the market, they all work real time. They work real time in terms of the moment that a sale will be closed, being the starting point for an export, but it also is a starting point for the goods to be stopped for leaving your warehouses if there is any sanction measure in place for that specific sale. Now, these are details, these are checks that are used within a real-time concept. It is, of course, important to know from a compliance perspective whether or not there are any offenses against the processes and procedures that you've put in place in order to avoid that consignments will leave your premises if that is not allowed. Now, these offenses, of course, are of interest. If you look at your internal organization, if you look at the way how everything is operated and how you try to be in control, that is where we come up with the solution, where we match the data with logistics data from a warehouse management system or from a transport management system in order to be 100% sure that through the real-time operation, looking at it retrospectively, that we don't miss any offenses or possibilities to offend against it. So far, this is what we wanted to share with you. If there are any questions, you are invited to pass them on. And otherwise, you can always reach out to us through the email addresses that we've entered on the last sheet. Thank you very much for your attending to this webinar.